Welcome to today's broadcast. I am sure you will be blessed at the end of this broadcast. Please stay tuned.
God is good. God is kind. Hallelujah. You know, it's not when something spectacular happens that you think it deserves a testimony. Amen. It's not when something spectacular happens. Sometimes there are things we just overlook. Praise God. Like the children of Israel, Acts 40:38, I've never seen it that way before. It says that the cloud of glory was upon the tabernacle. It says in the sight of all Israel, it never stopped. Exodus 40:38, it never stopped. They saw it, but they refused to focus on it. They considered the fact that they didn't have water. They considered the fact that it was only manna that they were eating. Look at it now. Exodus 40:38. Let's just look at it. Praise God. You see, testimony begets testimony. I just sat there and I was just listening. Spectacular testimonies. But that doesn't mean you don't have a testimony. The supernatural things are happening in your life every day. He said the cloud was upon the tabernacle by day and the fire was on it by night. In the sight of how many people? How many parts of their journey? That means when there was no water, the cloud was still there. When it was only manna they were eating every day, the cloud was there. But you know what? They never focused on the cloud. Something supernatural right in their sight. But they said, no, it's only this manna that is not working. It is only this one that is not happening. It is only that is not happening. Meanwhile, something supernatural. Do you know what it means to have a cloud of glory by and fire by night? They had 24-hour light. And yet they didn't notice it. In the sight of how many people? That means from their tabernacle, when they look at, there is no light. There's no water. We've not had water for 3 days. But when they look up and they see that cloud, they say, God is still with me. I don't care how I feel, but God is still with me. Are you getting the point? Supernatural things are happening and people are not noticing. Because you woke up in the morning and you had food to eat. You strode into your car, started the car, and you drove here. I want you to lift your hands and thank God. Bless his name. Father, we give you praise. Lord, we bless your name. We thank you. Sometimes people are waiting for musical equipment to bless God. You are waiting for emotions. You have goosebumps. That's when you want to thank God. No. We thank God whether we feel like it or not. We thank God whether things are adding up or not. On Friday I had something to do. At 5, 6 p.m., something came that kept me in the office till 9, 10. I already committed to the appointment. I was almost getting upset. I said, God, I thank you, I have a job. Thank you that I have a job. Thank you that I have a job that pays the bills. It may not look like what, I may not like what is happening now, but God, I'm grateful. How many of you are grateful? Things may not be happening the way you want it in your home, but Lord, I'm grateful. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. We are grateful. We are thankful. Not just when spectacular things happen. No. We are seeing the fire that was up on the tabernacle. We are seeing the cloud by day. We choose to focus on it. Thank you, Jesus. We give you praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In the same spirit, let's pray for the set man where he is in his journey, in his journeys as he's going. The Lord will be with him, sustain him, give him grace like never before. Open doors he never knew would be opened. Let God open last minute doors. That's what's coming to my mind. Last minute doors, last minute connections, last minute connections, last minute doors. Let's bless the set man. It's because of his obedience that we all gather there. Some of us would have died if he refused to obey God and he was going to follow his own plan, his own ideas. But look at you, look at me. Do you know how many of us that would have died if this church was not here? But thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. I wanted to release your faith this morning for the word, that the Lord will speak to you personally. He will speak to you specifically. Just release your faith and ask God. It's not about the person standing before you. Oh, if God can talk through a donkey, God can talk through me. Hallelujah. I have confidence in that. If God can speak through a donkey, he can speak through me. So let's pray. Ask God. Ask God to speak to you through me this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Take your seat in heavenly places. Take your seat in heavenly places. Media, are we ready? We'll soon just get on it until I give you a prompt. Thank you. I'd like to thank Pastor Inyi, Pastor Ngozi for the privilege to stand before God's people to share the word this morning. And I believe that God is going to reach out to you and God is going to touch you. I was so blessed by the testimonies. The testimonies blessed me. They enriched me. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Deacon Esikpa. Your testimonies were amazing. Amazing. Spectacular. Spectacular. God is faithful. God is always faithful. It's just that people don't listen. What if they did not listen and pray and say, you know what, it will be fine. Maybe you ate too much beans. That's what we're going to hear the story. Hallelujah. And you know, let me instill, something is just playing in my heart about when I mentioned to you that if the senior pastor was not here, some of us would be dead. I tell you, and somebody will tell me why God will work out somebody to come and, you know. Yes, but within that space, the enemy can throw in one and take out one or two or three people. Praise God. Do you know how many of us that maybe could have been driven by depression into suicide? Praise God. And that's why, you know, obedience to God is so critical, very important. Your obedience is not just about you. It affects, you know, there are people tied to you. And thank God for his obedience. And that's why we acknowledge the grace on him. And we say, thank you, God. Because some marriages are standing here today because they're in this house. Yes, sir. I'm telling you. I don't know why I'm talking like this, but that's how these things work. Yes, sir. David went and counted the armies of Israel. And 70,000 people died. But it's not them that counted. They were not even in the palace when David was having an argument with Joab about counting. But 70,000 people died. That's what happens when people disobey, especially people in leadership positions. There's collateral damage. And that's how things of the spirit work. It's good we learn those things. Praise God. And so why I told us to thank God is also part of the message I'm going to talk about today about the plan of God for our lives. Praise God. Before we do that, can we play a video? Are we ready, media? I just want us to watch a 4 or 5 minute video, something that will just get us thinking. Praise God. Media, are we ready?
Question. What are you called to do? I ask that question because we won't be judged according to what we did in life, but rather what we were called to do in life. Imagine with me standing before the throne of God and a scenario like this occur. Evangelist Anderson, come forth and give an account of your stewardship on earth. Evangelist Anderson, I'm not an evangelist, I'm an accountant. I had an accounting firm. I had an Evangelist Anderson. Where are the 347,566 souls I called you to impact in Asia, son? Where are they? I'm an accountant. I had an accounting firm. I help churches. I help ministries with their finances, son. Where are the 347,566 souls in Asia I called you to impact? Son, where are they? Had you sought me, had you sought my face, I would have revealed this to you. And everything in regards to that man's call was burnt up before the judgment seat of Christ. Accountant Jones, step forward and give an account of your stewardship. Accountant Jones?
No, I'm not.
I pastored for 35 years. I had a membership of 750 people. Accountant Jones, I called you to the marketplace. Had you done this, you would have significantly impacted two people. You and those two men would have helped churches with their finances, and those churches would have impacted 751,321 souls. If you would have sought me, I would have revealed this to you. And again, in regards to this man's calling, everything he's done in life would be burnt up before the judgment seat of Christ. Sister Smith, come forth and give an account of your stewardship. I only raised three children. I never preached to nations. I never even been on a missionary trip. I only tried my hardest to raise my children in your way. Sister Smith, I never called you to preach to nations. I never called you to go to other countries on missionary trips. I called you to raise three children. And let me show you 1,579,541 souls those three children impacted. You sought me and you heard my voice. You were obedient to my call. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord. So remember, in regards to the calling that's on your life, you won't be judged according to what you did. You will be judged according to what you were called to do.
Hallelujah. Media, please, you can help with the lights. Thank you. Did you get what we watched just now? Take me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10, the Amplified Classic Version. I believe you should take this thing seriously because it holds you accountable. You've already watched it. It's going to hold you accountable. There were three people. The first person was an accountant that was called to be a pastor. The accountant said that he had sown so much into the kingdom. I said, that's not what I called you to do. I called you to pastor churches. The second person, put it in Amplified Classic, the second person was a pastor that was called to be an accountant. And you say he had 750 members. I said, I'm not doubting what you did, but was that what you were called to do? The third person was an interesting sister with three children. And God told her, well done. That's all I called you to do. I didn't call you to go to the nations. I called you to just raise three children. And those children will impact 1.5 million and 70,000. By the time you began to mention, because you never know the impact of your faithfulness. The full impact on this side of the divide. And that's what I believe God has impressed in my heart to talk about today. And the title of the message is Walking Out God's Plan for Your Life. For every one of us here, God has a plan for you. I don't care how old you are. God does what? He has a plan for your life. And you can live through this earth and go through life, survive, live a nice life, have children, just do everything and go. You're not going to hell because you believed in Jesus. But you go to heaven, and when you step into heaven, the question is not whether you were supposed to be there. No, the blood of Jesus is going to bring you there. But the question is, what will be your position? Praise God. Let me just look at Hebrews chapter 6, verse 2, then we'll come back here immediately. I just want to point out something. And for everything I'm going to say, I like to go scripture by scripture. So you know that it's not my idea. It's the word. And people must begin to take responsibility for their lives. Amen. So with the time we have, we're just going to talk about walking out God's plan for your life. Hebrews chapter 6 verse 2. Let's look at it and then we'll come back here immediately. Now, Paul was talking about foundations. Let's start from verse 1. There are foundational teachings that every believer must have. He said, therefore, let us go on and get past the elementary stage in the teachings of the doctrine of Christ. That's what they call elementary. Advancing steadily towards the completeness and perfection that belongs to spiritual what? Maturity. Let us not again be laying the foundation. Somebody say foundation. Foundation. You need to have that foundation before you can even start growing. There's no way to be in a building if there is no foundation. You get the point? So the next element is the things that make up this foundation. So what is the first foundation? He said the foundation of repentance and abandonment of dead works, dead formalism. And then the second one is of faith by which you turn to God. Verse 2. With teachings about purifying the laying on of hands. Those are foundational teachings. See, you've not even gone to the mature ones. He said, then there's the part I'm coming to, the resurrection from the dead. I know at some point here I've talked about resurrection of the dead. But the last one here is the one that is very interesting. And eternal judgment and punishment. He said, these are all matters of which you should have been fully aware long, long ago. You sit with believers. People don't really understand what eternal judgment is. Do you know what eternal means? Just as I'm talking, take me back to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10. Amplified Classic. Do you know what eternal means? Eternal means that they don't bring it up for review. It's forever and ever. Now, you know what eternal judgment means? Judgment means coming to a decision after an investigation. That's what true judgment really is. I mean, when you see a judge sit in the court, people bring evidences and then the judge makes a decision after investigating the evidences. Are you following me, church? So, when you talk about eternal judgment, means that your life on earth, in fact, a man of God said, he said, this is the briefest thing we're ever going to have, this life we live. It is the briefest thing we are ever, ever going to have. Eternity is long and it is forever. And the thing about the judgment is not judgment about whether you are going to heaven or hell per se for every true believer in Christ Jesus. It is about what will be your position in the eternal kingdom. I'm preaching to you about the kingdom of God. Amen. Are you following me? Please, I hope I'm not dampening you. Okay. This will be good for you. So, look at what it says here. Let me be less. It says, for we must all appear and be revealed as we are before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what? His pay. Tell somebody there's a pay coming. Have you remember when Pastor Ngoji says that the reaper and the sower, they will get their own rewards, right? He will receive his pay according to what he has done in the body. That means you're no longer in the body. And that was what that video, they had left their body. And they were now standing before God. And God was now judging them according to something. And I will come to what that something is. Praise God. He said, according to what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Now, I went to look at the meaning of that word evil. It includes bad, but it also includes another term, worthless. So, for the believer, we will call it whether it was good or what? Worthless. There are things that, let me give you an example. What could be worthless? My brother, what's your name? Benjamin. And I told Benjamin, Ben, I need you to clean up this place. I need to see my face here. And by the time I come, Benjamin did not touch one thing here. But Benjamin went outside, cut the grass, cleared everything, cleaned everything. If I enter here, am I going to commend Benjamin for cleaning that place? Where I will judge Benjamin is what I told him to do. I don't know. This thing is going back to that about Saul. But that's not where I'm going to, really. So, What Benjamin did, no matter how nice it is what? Worthless. So, considering, so how does he judge? He will receive his pay according to what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Considering what his purpose and motive have been, and what he has achieved, been busy with, and giving himself and his attention to accomplishing. That's how we're going to be judged. Have you ever read in the scriptures, because of time, I'm not going to go there. Have you ever read in the scripture where he says that they were judged according to what was written in the books? And then the next thing was, anybody whose name was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Now, remember that there are books. The question we should be asking is, what are these books? Amen. What are these books? Let's go to Psalm 40. Maybe that would help us to understand. Or Psalm 139. Let's look at Psalm 139, verse 15 and 16. I'm just laying a foundation and then we'll try and run through. Psalm 139, 15 and 16. Now, how many of you have read that scripture where Jesus said, "Lo, I come, in the volume of the book, it is written of me to do your will"? So that means before Jesus came, there's a book about him. You will see that in Hebrews, I think Hebrews chapter 10, and also in Psalm 40. But I didn't want to take you there because somebody in his mind may argue, but that is Jesus. Let's look at a man. This is the Psalm of David. David, the man after God's own heart. David, the man that took Bathsheba. David, the man that killed Uriah. Let's read his story. From verse 15, he said, "My frame was not hidden from you when I was being formed in secret and intricately and curiously wrought, as if embroidered with various colors in the depths of the earth, a region of darkness and mystery." Verse 16. He said, "Your eyes saw my unformed substance, and in your book," how many days of my life? All the days of my life were written before they ever took shape, when as yet there was none of them. That means there are no mistakes with God. Before Benjamin came in on planet Earth, whether you came in through legitimate parents or illegitimate parents, there was something written in the book concerning you before they ever thought of you. And that's why you will see scriptures, they say, "Before you were formed in the womb, I knew you." There is nobody on this planet sitting here before me, listening to me, that there is no book concerning you. Everybody here has a book. Tell yourself, there is a book about me. Whether you feel like it, some of you may have come here from the useless, but that doesn't change the fact that there is a book. Somebody here may be feeling useless, but can I tell you something? It's either God lied, or that thing that is whispering to you is lying. He said, "In your book." Whose book? Not in your own book. He said, "In your book, all the days, day one, day two, day three, even the days when it looks as if nothing is happening," he said, "they were written before they ever took shape." You see, that is one thing that should help you give testimony. That when you step out there and say, "Thank you, Father, you have a plan for my life. I may not feel like it, but Lord, I thank you. Woo! Glory to Jesus. God has a plan. It doesn't look like it, but God has a plan. Oh, thank you, Lord." People don't get excited about it. You see, for God to take you so important and precious to him, and he wrote things every day of your life. You know, when Jesus says all the hairs of your hair are numbered, Pastor Chiki, I'm not taking a shade at you, but God knew when they started falling. The angel informed, they said, okay, how many are going to fall? Okay, face it. At this stage, it will be off. Let's leave it. But compensate it. Give him sideburns. Give him beard. Let it grow. You see, he said all the hairs of your head are what? They are not counted. They are numbered. What is number? Number one, strand. Number two, strand. Number three, strand. You know, you need to begin to appreciate these things so that you can begin to put faith in the fact that God has a plan for my life. God has a plan for these children that are with me. God has a plan for this marriage. God has a plan for this job. God has a plan. And but the thing is that we don't feel like it every day. It's not. In fact, I don't have time to go through the scriptures. When you look at Jacob, that time Joseph had not revealed himself. He said, go. Joseph told his brother, go and bring Benjamin. When they came and told their father, what did Jacob say? Jacob said, you people have taken Joseph. Now you want to take Benjamin. All these things are against me. Kai. The power of perspective, it changes everything.
Yes, sir.
Jacob, the patriarch, said all these things are against me. Not knowing that God was using that adversity to bring him closer to destiny. Tell yourself, God has a plan for my life. You see, those things encourage me a lot, because sometimes for those of you that work, it will look as if the office does not have a plan for you. But you know what? You sit back and say, even if you don't have a plan, God has a plan. Even if you don't have a plan, God has it. That is where faith grows. You talk to yourself. A lot of people are disquieted. They are disquieted. But you know, God is not going to quiet it for you. That's why David said, why are you downcast, O my soul? Why are you disquieted within me? Hope thou in God, for I will yet praise him. That's in Psalm 42. You see repeated again in Psalm 43. Listen, sometimes you need to talk to depression. It's not that it will not come. It will come and say, why are you downcast? Question your soul. Why are you feeling this way? Why are you going to let this get a hold on you? No. Hope in God. I will yet praise him. That's why sometimes I've grown through the emotions of people that work with their emotion. So when the music is loud, they roll. But when it's not loud, they feel like the whole world has fallen on them. No, don't wait for emotion. Stay yourself. That's how people enter into things in God.
Yes, sir.
Am I making sense to you?
Yes, sir.
You have to stop being over. I'm not saying that you should remove your emotions. But negative emotions, question it.
Yes.
Challenge it. Say, why are you downcast? Hope in God. Why are you disquieted? And that's why I keep maintaining this thing. I keep telling myself, because it's not that I don't have this, that I don't feel bad. But I'm not going to let it get to me. So I tell myself, no, believers, we should be the happiest people. The Moshakeri are really the happiest people on earth. Oh, this man wrote a story. I was just reading it. A book by J. Lee Grady. How many of you know him? He was the editor of Charisma. He wrote a very interesting book they call 10 Lies the Church Tells Women. But there was one he wrote. He said he went on a mission trip to Cuba. How many of you know Cuba was under Fidel Castro? Communism. Then they banned churches. It was in 1990 that Fidel Castro then said, okay, let Christianity continue. So he said when he went there, I think it was before they banned it. He said he met one of the pastors, the Methodist pastor, they talked. You know, they go on mission trips, these people. And the man told him, okay, come and see one of the underground churches. He said he thought it was going to be, they used to have house churches. They don't have, because of the ban on religion, a public show of religion, they banned, you know, congregating together. So they used to have house churches. So he said, come to one of the places. You know, and you know, all these communist countries, they are very poor because distribution of goods and production is centrally managed. There is no incentive for entrepreneurs to do business because government will still collect what you've made and share it. So there's a lot of poverty in those places. So what happened was that he said he followed the man. I'm thinking it was going to be a house fellowship of a house church of 12 people. He said he saw thousands there. He said where they gathered was like, you know, he said it was a dingy place. The only light they had was just something hanging, lantern. But he said when he saw these people praise God, He looked into their eyes and he said, with all my American Christianity, there is something these people have I don't have. Ah! He said, the way they praised God, the way the word came, you could see that in these places, that's where the dead are raised. You know, a lot of us, we watch TV and think that's where we see the dead raised. There are things that God is doing that you don't even know.
Yes, sir.
I tell you.
Yes, sir.
In those hidden places, he said he saw that thing. When he finished, he was not talking with the man of God. So they were talking about how they will try and train some pastors to multiply the house churches and all that. He said he will bring some materials and all that. He said he was flying back to the U.S. A thought came to him that, okay, maybe we should bring some American preachers to come and talk to this. We said, no. These American preachers are already corrupted. They are so money-minded. They will just come and spoil this thing that God is doing. Because, you know, it is until everything is stripped from you that we'll understand what you really believe. Do you get my point? And that's why the purpose of God is so important. Was it not yesterday? Where were we even listening to it? Somebody said, most times, you know, it's when people are released from the restrictions of the environment where they are. Maybe God opens a door and they fly to the U.S. or they went and forced the door open and they go abroad. Yes, you don't know that people force doors open. It's in the scripture. You can ask for things. It's not that God is not the one that is giving you. He will give you, but it will bring leanness to your soul. You see, I don't know. Yeah, God answers prayers. I must marry this man.
Glory.
I must marry him. And God said, this is what's going to happen. I said, I want him, Lord. Lord, this has to happen. And he will give you. It's not the devil that is giving you. He will give you. It will bring leanness to your soul. So back to the analogy I was giving. People who force the door open and travel. And they go there. And they see me. And they will start blaming God. It's not God, though. You chose your path. And that's why I'm bringing you to this thing about what? The plan of God. Hallelujah. Because of time, I'm not going to finish everything, but I just want to encourage you. Why do we need to connect with God's plan? There are things I will talk about. I may not be able to finish everything, but it's just good. Something to help you get started. Why do we need to connect with God's plan for our lives? I've told you that there is a book about you. If you notice in that video, the person that acted as God kept telling those people, if you had sought me, I would have revealed to you what I wanted you to do. If you had just said, I'm going to take time out, God, what would you have me do? It's not that God, this is what I want to do. Come and bless it. No, there are two different things. Amen? They're what? Two different things. It's one thing to bring your own idea and say, God, bless it. It's another thing to sit back and say, God, what would you have me do? Tell me, show me. There are two completely different things. One will produce an Ishmael. That God will still bless you, but he will not inhabit. The other one will produce the promise, Isaac. It never changes. See, the truth is, you see how they address them. When they call them, say evangelist, so-and-so. You say, I'm not an evangelist, I'm an accountant. And you think God will change his mind. Oh, okay, so you did. Okay, let's manage. Let's cancel it and put an account out. This is not Nigerian government. This is not Nigerian civil service. This is not Nigerian police. God will stick to what he called you to do. And it's that path. And I tell you, some people will. I'll give you an example. How many of you go to YouTube and watch it? Have you watched Jesse Duplantis' vision of heaven? That he visited heaven. The Lord took him to heaven. Go watch it. You see it. It was not until 2020. This is something that happened, I think, in the 80s or 70s. He was not released to tell the full story until 2020. And he told that story. And he said truth. That he saw some people were wearing rich gowns. And some other people, it was just a simple garment. He said he saw John F. Kennedy there. I don't know when he made his peace with God. But he said he saw him there. But that he was wearing a simple gown. That means his works on earth did not align with the plan of heaven. No matter how famous he was here, no matter how many of you have landed at JFK International Airport in New York, they say he just saw him with a simple. So what happened? He was just saved. I'm not sure if there was any reward. Just go watch the video. I heard him say that. And that's why, you know, because God plays the long game. Finish this. See, and that's what I keep telling myself.
I tell colleagues at work, I say, the way things are going, I have less than 20 years to retire. No matter how important I am to the system, by 60, they will retire me. Why am I acting like a landlord? Swivel chair mentality, you scroll over, and you look through the window. You think you're a big man. Everybody comes to greet you. My dear, when you turn 60, it's done. People must have that level of thinking and maturity. I mean, it's almost 26 years. In fact, 26 years since Papa Idehosa passed. Other men have stepped in. We recognize his legacy. But he has gone to his reward. We heard of Brother Jerry Savelle that passed on 2 weeks ago. He's gone on to his reward. The ministry will continue. You see, God plays the long game. How many years do you have? And that's why I keep insisting. You need to plan for the afterlife. Not just to make heaven. Am I doing what God called me to do? I'm not talking about just getting rewards here on earth. No. Because you see, when you start playing the long game, every decision, every action, everything you do will begin to align. What will God think of this on the last day? The way I'm treating this person, how is God going to view it? It's not just so that God can bless me now. That's okay. But listen, if you're going to play the long game, think about the afterlife. And remember, it's eternal judgment. Your position is set after that. We just have this time to plan for that life. And that's what God is calling us to. Am I making sense to you? Praise God. Praise God. So the first thing why we need to connect with God's plan is that it is the basis on which we are going to be judged for our eternal reward. Nothing else. That video, that's what it says. That is why, how we're going to be judged. The second thing is this. Why you need to know the plan of God. I've read scriptures and I've noticed that your gifts come before the call. So the second reason is that, listen, you need to know the call of God so that your gifts can be operated in an arena where it is created for effective maximization. Go to Romans 11:29. Your gifts can what? Be operated in an arena where it can be utilized for effective maximization. I will explain that. Look at this. What did he say? For the gifts. Somebody say gifts. Is it in singular or plural? And what? How many? Singular. Of God are what? Without repentance. So when God gives you a calling, gifts come with it. But the thing is that people run and go rogue with their gifts and not asking God, how and where and when do you want me to deploy these gifts? Michael Jackson's gift didn't come from hell. It was God-given. And God had a plan for it. It is not for me to judge whether he used it according to God's plan. That's none of my business. But I'm just trying to give you an example. Now, let me explain one to you. We'll look at the scriptures. David was multi-talented. How many of you know that? The Bible called him a psalmist, a prophet, a warrior, a king, and a shepherd. What was the first gift that was manifested in his life? Shepherd and a psalmist. He was playing music. Could you have imagined that David could have said, this is my gift. Let me start holding music concerts. Let them be inviting me. And it's not bad. But if he sticks there and never sits down to say, God, how do you want me? And you know, at each phase in his life, there was a particular gift that was being emphasized. Do you know that if David had continued as a psalmist, he would have only done 1/5 of what God told him to do? He wouldn't have killed Goliath. He would never have been king, which was the ultimate plan of God. But what did he start with? He started with him what? Shepherding and playing music. Play music to sheep that may not fully appreciate. And that's why sometimes as a choir person you come and you are singing and people are not moving and you're like, this is not working. And then you get so impatient that you step out and say, God, I'm going to form something for myself. And not knowing that God is ordering your steps. He takes you from one place to the other till he brings you to the optimum place where your gift is now fully maximized. Everything comes together. I call it the convergence point. The psalmist comes, the warrior comes in, The shepherd comes in and the king shows up and the prophet is there. In fact, in Acts chapter 13, chapter 2, verse 29, they call David a prophet. But David could have stuck with one or two. But do you know how he was able to get to that point? He walked with God. Each time you see him inquiring of God. I'll give you a second example. How many of you know Moses was called to deliver? But you know that the gift of deliverance was already on him. Can I show you? Let's look at the Bible. Exodus chapter 2. Let's read verse 16. You already know the one where the Bible says that he killed an Egyptian. Do you know that that's deliverance? He was delivering one person. Now, look at the second one. He said, now the priest of Midian has 7 daughters, and they came and drew water and filled the troughs with water to water their father's flock. Verse 17. Verse 17, please. And the shepherds came and drove them away. But Moses stood up and helped them and watered their flock. Verse 18. And when they came to Reuel, their father, that's Jethro, he said, how is it that you have come so soon today? Verse 19. And they said, an Egyptian did what? An Egyptian did what? You see that grace for deliverance. The first one, he did it when he killed and delivered one man. This second one was 7 people. But God was building it. And you know, as a shepherd, because he kept his father-in-law's flock, he was also delivering the sheep. So that thing was working. The gift was working until it came to a point where God started with 1, moved to 7. Jethro has 7 daughters, moved to a couple of sheep, and then he now came to a nation. But what if he had received that deliverance and formed prayer house? Say, let's start delivering people individually. The way the gifts come, the gifts usually come before the calling. It's now for you to be faithful with the gifts, and God will start ordering it, okay? I don't want you to prophesy today. I know people are putting pressure on you to give a word. Don't prophesy. Keep quiet. Just teach the word. And God begins to measure your faithfulness, okay? You've been faithful here. Let's move you further. So the water moves from ankle. It's the same water. It comes to your knee. He measures another 1,000 steps. You take 1, 2, and that consistency and faithfulness, as he's measuring it, he said, come this way. You are not going this way. You are not going that way. You're just staying faithful. You're just staying faithful. You're just staying faithful. When it gets, the water will move from here to here. You know, some things don't come by fasting and praying. They come by faithfulness. As you stay faithful, God increases the anointing. He enlarges your coasts. He keeps expanding until you get to a point where he's like, okay, finally, you have entered your call. Let's start. A lot of us are in training ground. It's just, what are we doing with the training plan? Because the training plan may not look like a training. Hallelujah. The training plan may not what? Look like a training. And the third other reason why we need to connect with God's plan for our life is that your fulfillment in life is tied to walking in God's plan. I can tell you. I'll share a story with you. I remember those days when I got a prophetic word. The person said, you know what? You get to a point, God will bless you, but you will not be satisfied. You will be, Can I tell you, God has helped me. Financially, God has helped me. But guess what? I don't find peace in it. And that's why I say money will not solve the problem. A lot of people say, just stop talking that nonsense. I said it too. I beg you, money will not solve the problem. It's a problem of direction. It's a problem of purpose. It's not a problem of money. A lot of people stay pedestrian. Oh, this. No. When you get on the path of the plan, Ephesians 2:10, so that you will see how that scope of the plan works. When you get on the plan, you will see the good life. It may not look like it immediately, but you will ultimately enter. Look at it in Amplified, where his workmanship created in Christ unto good works, which God has before ordained. That means ahead of time, he did that we should walk in them. Look at it in Amplified Classic. He said, for we are God's own handiwork, his workmanship, recreated in Christ Jesus, born anew, that we may do those good works which God predestined. I can repeat to you that there are works that God predestined for you to do. He said, planned beforehand for us. How are we going to do those works? By taking paths. He leads me in the paths of righteousness. They are not paths of convenience. They are right path. That's why you're on the right path, International Ministries. Hallelujah. Taking parts which he prepared when? Ahead of time that you should do what? Walk in them. Living what? See, God has a good life for you. Now me talk am. No. Living the good life which he did what? Prearranged. See, there are things that God has arranged. Let me give you an example. If God has planned for you to go through Ikorodu Road to get to VI, and you say, no, they just finished constructing Third Mainland. It looks neater. But along the path to Ikorodu Road, God has arranged a good life. He has planned that, oh, your tire may burst, is weak. I have stationed vulcanizers that will do it free of charge for you. I have put this thing here where you can park and eat free of charge. He has prearranged the good life. Somebody say, the good life has been prearranged. Was it Pastor Ngozi that was saying? No, somebody said that they said, the person said, leave all that you have and come. Everything is ready, plug and play. And as she was saying it, that scripture dropped in my heart in Genesis. When Joseph told Jacob, he said, forget all your stuff. Come. The Lord gave me that word, 2010. He said, see, where I'm taking you to, you will not need anything you came with up to this point. And I've seen it come to pass. He said, listen, there is a good life which he has prearranged and made ready. It's not you trying to make things ready. The reason why people and may not be seeing the good life, number one, they could be impatient. Because sometimes you go 3 days, there is no water in the wilderness, and you start complaining. Oh! They look at this. They took their own path. And so, if you decided to take Third Mainland, you won't see all the things that have been arranged. It's like somebody here in Lagos, you showed up in Lagos. They told you that that is where it's happening. Meanwhile, God has planned your life in Sokoto. They've set your room. They've built a path, a special pathway where you'll be having audience with the governor of Sokoto State. But because you said it has to be Lagos, all my family is in Lagos. You are missing out on it. You do all night. You do night vigil. You are doing everything. And as you keep doing it, it still comes up in your heart. Sokoto. Say, no. Ah, Lord! They shout in prayer and they are shutting it down. But it's there. It is there. Because the gifts and calling of God, God does not call it back. It is there.
Yes, sir.
If you will be quiet enough and look inside, it is there. It is there. Yeah. Tell yourself it is there. You don't have a junior Holy Ghost. It is there.
Yes, sir.
If you can just take time to say, okay, fine. What is it? Tell yourself there's a good life. Sometimes the path you are on may not look like it's leading to the good life. And that's where I always encourage myself. There's a plan. Thank you, Jesus. There is a plan. I'm not intelligent enough to know whether what is going to happen. I really don't know, but I don't care. But I'm going to trust you. And you know, one of the most important things that will help you navigate this plan is that you must believe and settle it today that God is good. If you don't settle it, you will always have it at the back of your mind that God wants to shortchange me. Or that God is not nice to me. Or that God does not care about me. If you don't settle it, you will always struggle. First thing and only thing you must settle is that God is good and he has my best interests at heart. When he tells me take this step, I don't know what it looks like. Was it not last week? The Lord said ministering to me from about that guy, the turning of water to wine. They were looking for wine. You know, we have the benefit of reading the whole of John 2. That's why we can come to conclusion, okay, we know that this is how the wine was formed. But those servants that stood there, they didn't know the next step. The first thing Jesus told them was what? Fill the water pots with water. If you were me, I would argue. This doesn't look like it. I did ask for wine. You're telling me fill the water pots with water. What connection has water with wine? And that's how a lot of people rationalize themselves out of the plan. His plan is not your plan.
Yes, sir.
Fill the water pots with water. They didn't question. They just went. They will carry it. Do you know, I've explained to you here before that those water pots were what they used to wash hands before they eat, clean their body, perform their ablution. As you can see in Mark 7. So they kept doing it. Imagine somebody said, what are you guys doing? They said, we should fill the water pots with water. Oh, but it no be wine when I want. But that's what he said we should do. Yeah, say, people have become, obviously, this thing don't take over you people. Carry it. They filled They did not go once. They did not go twice. They did not go three times. They must have gone 10 times. Feeling and feeling. Guess what? Jesus didn't say anything to them. It was when they finished feeling it that he now gave them the next step. A lot of people are waiting till they tell them, okay, you go to point A, and then from point A, I will take you to point B, then point C, and then you will now land in VI where you want to go to. No. It's the first step. You trust that God is good, take the first step. I take the first step. I don't know where I'm taking it. And you know, that's why God loves Abraham. 75-year-old man. And God tells him, come, leave your father's house. Leave all you've known. Your bankers, your relatives, your age grade, your friends, people that you have known. He said, come, I will take you to the land that I'm going to tell you of. First, you did not even tell him the land. He said, just be going. We will tell you where you are going to. Imagine Abraham packing. Sir, Daddy Abby, what's going on? Say, say we should move. Who said you should move? They didn't even know God. Say, God said I should move. Say, which God? I had an encounter. He appeared to me. He said I should move. So where are you going to? Where, give us the address where we can meet you. Sir, I don't know. You know, I don't know. Take your son Isaac. Go and sacrifice him in one of the mountains I will tell you of. Mountain, you don't know. You take the boy. You have a wife. Sarah did like this before they gave birth to that child. Do you notice that finally Abraham was living somewhere else, Sarah was living somewhere else after that event? But we'll talk about it. He didn't even consult. That's why God says, see, you see this guy? As I live. You know when God swears by himself? May God bring us there. Hallelujah. This is one of the reasons why you need to connect with God's plan, is that the good life is there. He has parts he has prearranged. Before we close, because of time, the next thing, I'll just touch on it briefly, is finding and pursuing God's plan. I've already talked about pursuing, but finding, preparing, and pursuing his plan. Let's look at Exodus 3, 1 to 4. Because it's not just enough to come and tell you that there's a plan, but it's good for you to start finding out. It's good for you to even sit back and say, okay, what's the plan? Now, Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. Verse 2, and the angel of the Lord appeared to him. Who was the appearance to? It was to Moses. But guess what? In a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. Look at verse 3. And Moses said, what did he say I would do? He was leading a flock, and he said, I will turn aside. You know what turning aside means? I will go out of my way. A lot of people are casual seekers. That's why you don't get the picture. You are casual about some things. And it doesn't come to people that casualize God. Maybe some people need adversity to get them to the place where, if this money doesn't come, I'm finished. I'm going to spend time till I see the end. People are casual. He was leading sheep. He said, you know what? I will now turn aside. So the first thing is, learn to turn aside. It will not always fit your shadow. Turn aside. And do what? See this great sight. You must begin to place a value on the things God is showing you. He called it a great sight. Why the bush is not burnt? He was curious. Three things I'm seeing here. Learning to turn aside, placing value on what God is showing you, and number three is curiosity, spiritual curiosity. God, what? God, show me. God, I want to know. God, I want to know. You know, some people carry this faithless attitude to say, well, if God wants me to know, he will show me. My dear, you will live and die, you will know. It comes to people that are serious-minded. And that's the same thing about the Apostle Paul. When the Apostle Paul met Jesus on the way, what did Jesus tell him? As soon as Jesus told him, Saul, why do you persecute me? He said, who are you, Lord? He said, I'm Jesus whom you persecute. The next question he asked, he didn't even waste time. He said, what would you have me do? Did Jesus answer him immediately? No. Some people give up when it has not answered in one day. What did Jesus tell him? He said, go into the city and there it shall be told you what you must do. For the next 3 days, he was fasting and praying before God tapped Ananias. Why didn't God tap after the first day? Why didn't God tap after the second day? Why was it the third day? Sometimes God needs to see your persistence. You must place value on the things of the Spirit. And that's why he says, cast not your pearls before swine. Don't give that which is holy to the dogs. You see, a woman with a without a, in fact, Bible says in the book of Proverbs that as a gold ornament is in the snout of a pig, so is what? So is a beautiful woman that is without discretion. That is, you're giving an earring to a pig. God is not going to do that. He needs people that will place value on his things. Place value on showing up in church. Place value on submitting to leadership. Place value on being planted in church. Even when you don't understand the fullness of the purpose. Say, God, I will serve you anywhere until you tell me. You are placing value on his things. And he sees you humbling yourself, arranging the chairs, cleaning this. And say, God, I'm still waiting, but thank you. Yeah. Oh, God, I'm willing to do anything in church. Whatever they say, if it's to cut grass, we'll do it. And they're still doing it. They're doing it. See, start somewhere. Yes, I know you are waiting, but do something. Find somewhere. I heard a story. A man of God was street preaching, and you see, they came to meet a guy, and they told the guy, you know, we need some people that will come and help with something mundane in church. He said, no. I've been called to a prophetic ministry. The prophet had prophesied, and you know, you see, that's a prophet only gives you a snippet. A true prophet, they don't even know the full details, so they now call you. I'm a prophet. And you don't know the first step to being that prophet might be to go and wash toilets. You know, prophet, toilets, they sound alike somehow. But people are not ready to do that. No. God has called me to be a prophet. I like seat. I like front seat. Hey, joker. You won't see it. No. You won't. You won't. No, I don't want to get into it. God has a call on my life. Ah, you don't know the first step to the call. A.A. Allen, the first time God told him he had a great ministry, he showed up in church. They said, we don't have any position but the position of a janitor. God start washing toilets. Like me, toilets. After he humbled himself and started, he started growing. God will start you. Just start from wherever. Because at some point, you will be general contractor, clearing forwarding. And when God sees faithfulness, that you are willing to do this, do that, he will now begin to streamline you. Stop feeling you are too big for the things of the Spirit. Turn aside and see the great sides. Are you getting the point? Turn aside and see the great side. Learn submission. Learn obedience. I remember a time in my life then, ministry, oh God, I'm not hearing the call. And I remember, God in his mercy, a prophetic man told me something. He said, God says, love your wife. Take care of your family. And I've been doing that for more than how many years of my life. I will keep doing it. Because you need to come to a point where you are ready to say, you know what, God? If this is what you want me to do for the rest of my life, I will do it. And when God sees that heart, he will raise a man. Well, you have a lot of people with ambition. Let's talk about ambition here. Glory to God. Are you getting something? Listen, in finding and preparing for God's plan, I'm going to say this and then I will give you some tests you may need to pass if you must be appointed and chosen, because many are called but few are chosen. Two things I'm going to mention now. The first one is this. To prepare, you see, you must learn to separate your ambition from God's allotment to you. Everybody has an inheritance in God. But you must separate your ambition. Ambition always steps in the way. Let's go and look at the ogre of ambition, Satan. Ezekiel chapter 28, 11 to 15. I need to talk about this. You need to get it so that you can begin to sift ambition from what is actually God's allotment. Because I've been there. Exodus 28, and then from there we'll go to Isaiah 14, and then we'll cure the matter with Psalm 131. Ezekiel 28, please, 11 to 15, because of time. Ezekiel 28, but please, are you getting something? I believe that at the end of this, that God will take us into places, his plan for our lives. We will follow him closely, even if it doesn't make sense. Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me saying, verse 12, son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyre. That's a type of Satan. He was using it as a description. And say unto him, thus saith the Lord, thou sealest up the sum, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Verse 13. You have been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering. The sardius, the topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, the carbuncle, and gold. The workmanship of your tablets and of your pipes was prepared in you in the day that you were created. What are these carbuncle and pipes? Musical equipment. When Lucifer does like this, bam, you hear music. Hallelujah. That was how God created him. He said, you are the anointed cherub that covereth. But where I want to confirm is this, I have set you so. How do you set something? This speaker is set here. This speaker cannot say, why is this one here? I want to be here. No. He said, I have set you so. But come and look at what started happening to Lucifer. Isaiah 14, we'll read from verse 12. Isaiah 14, we will read from verse 12. You begin to have that agitation. You must separate your ambition from God's allotment to you. And that's why it's not just about your desire. You must kneel down and sift it in his presence. I speak from experience. How you have fallen from heaven. You know, God set him. Eden was in heaven. How you have fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations. Look at the next thing. It says here, for you have said where? See, he was not saying it openly. He was still leading praise and worship. But in his heart, ambition was hiding like this. He said it where? In his heart. He said what? He said, I will ascend into heaven. You know there is the heaven of heavens. He said, I will ascend into heaven. What does ascend mean? I want to rise. I will exalt my throne above where? The stars. Who are the stars of God? The angels. But he was already an archangel. What else was he looking for? Look at the next thing. He said, I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the size of the north. That's where God sits. And then look at the next verse. He said, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds, and I will do what? I will be like. It is, I want to exalt myself above him. He said, I want to be like him. I will be like the Most High. You know what he was doing? He was trying to leave his estate. The allotment God gave him, he wanted to stretch into another allotment. And that's why it is very important. Anybody that God will use, you must separate your ambition from your what? From your allotment. I have ambition to be this, this, this. What is my allotment? Find it, stay there. And it does. God can also expand your allotment. Maybe some people will not fulfill their call. God will take what they've not done and give you. Because you are faithful. And it's in scripture, Matthew 25, the guy that had 5 talents. When this other guy did not, he said, take it and give it to this other person. That is scripture. Are you getting my point, church? How do you cure this thing? Psalm 131. And interestingly, it's a psalm of David. A very interesting psalm. David was called to be a warrior. He was called to be a king. He was called to be a psalmist. He was called to be a shepherd. That guy was multi-talented. But God also had to bring him to a point where he made a decision about his life. He said, Lord, my heart is not haughty, nor my eyes lofty. Don't you think that when they told him he was going to be the king of Israel, he would sit down and they dream? Ah, the day where I go sit for this place. But when God took him through process, he came to a point and said, God, my heart is not haughty. My eyes are not lofty. Neither do I exercise myself in great matters or in things too high for me. I don't know how this kingship is going to happen, but God, you know, I trust you. Even if it doesn't happen, I'm okay with you. One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after. I'm not looking for kingship, that I might dwell in the house of the Lord and behold the beauty of the Lord and inquire in his temple. That was his ambition. A holy one at that. It was not to be king anymore. Hallelujah. He says, surely I behaved and what? You see, a lot of people are having disquiet because of ambition. So they are not content to stay where they are. They put me on as an usher. They don't know I'm a prophet. I came for this meeting. They did not recognize me. No, I'm talking to people here. I don't know who I'm talking to. But I'm here. Ah! They don't recognize me. Do they know who I am? Do they know how many words of knowledge I've given this last week, Joker? Who gave you the words of knowledge? He says, surely I have behaved and quieted myself. as a child that is weaned of his mother. Do you know what it means to be weaned? I mean, mothers here, you will understand how to wean a child. Wah! I want it now. It's pain. I'm not giving you. I want it now. You cry. Cry. That recognition you're looking for is not coming. That promotion is not coming. Oh, that platform is still not coming. Ah! You say, no, you know what? I will behave and quiet myself. Quiet. A meek and quiet spirit. Quiet. As a child that is weaned of his mother. You see, in case you don't know, he's talking about my soul. Look at it back. Go back. My soul is even as a weaned child. You must kill yourself of ambition if you must walk in the plan of God. Because some people don't get satisfied because their eyes are on something that God is not showing them. Do you get the point? Your eyes are on something God is showing you. But God has blessed you with this, and this. But your eyes are not there. Because your eye is on an imagination that is born out of your ambition. But you must behave and quiet yourself. Behave and quiet yourself. Praise God. Lastly, how do we begin to connect with this plan? You see, the call to follow. When God gives you a call, many are called, but few are chosen. And that's why I'm rounding up, please. Just give me time. 10 minutes. But I want you to know where you are today. There are tests that are being passed. And every day the tests are passing. And opportunities are being lost. Because people don't understand those tests. Luke chapter 9. And I'll read from verse 57 to chapter 10, 1 to 2. And we'll close. Please just give me this time. I just want to drop this and then we'll go. You see, there are tests. Because when you start walking on God's path, there are tests that come to prove you. And those tests are not to come to fail you. Remember the analogy we gave of the plane. When you take the plane to the cold region and the Sahara region, it's not to show that there's something wrong with the plane. It's just to confirm the capacity of that plane to carry people from one place to another. Are you getting my point? Luke chapter 9, verse 57, please. Verse 57. Jesus was in the way. He was on his way to Jerusalem. Verse 57. He was on his way to Jerusalem. And Bible says, and it came to pass, as they went in the way, a certain man said unto him, Lord, I will follow you whithersoever you goest. Enthusiasm is good, though. Hey, Father, I'm going to walk with you. I've done that. He said, okay, you want to walk with me? Okay, that person that you have been quarreling with, I need you to go and apologize to that person. We are not able to connect it with, I will follow you. But my brother, that is part of following. He said, that group leader that you are not submitting to, I want you to make a call and say, I apologize. But you see, people are looking for high-sounding things. Following starts with this one. I will follow you. Look at verse 58. What did Jesus answer? And Jesus said to him, say, foxes have holes. Birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. The first test is the first test of security. Jesus was telling him, I don't even know where I'm going to sleep this night. Now where sun set, now there I go sleep. Everybody likes some stability. Yeah. Women, don't you like stability? When you meet a man and the man tells you, so what's the plan? Say, well, God has a plan. Say, now God plan, where I go to? Is it what this one I'm going to eat? My friend, please do something. Yeah. What did Jesus tell the disciples? He said, Lord, I will follow you. He said, see, my brother, I don't even know where I'm going to sleep this night. The guy would have shocked. So this one called on the Lord and said, God, please. The second one, security. Verse 59. And he said unto another, follow me. The man said, Lord, suffer me first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all. You see, there's a problem of priority here. He said, suffer me first to go and bury my father. Is it not legitimate? He didn't say, God, please suffer me. Let me go to the beer parlor the last time. Let me do the sin. No, these were legitimate things. What did Jesus tell him in verse 60? He said, just let the dead bury their dead, but go and preach the kingdom of God. If you look, I bought the Living Bible version. If you look at the footnotes there, the way they explained it was this. That's it. Why people rush to go and bury their father is because if you're not there,
Somebody will misread it now. Save meaning, I know Pastor Chike has done it quite a number of times. Go and empty your account. That's the safety. You know, we like safety. I love safety. I like you putting it 1, 2, 3, 4. So I see where it is going to end. But in this how many years of knowing Jesus, it doesn't work like that. So Lord, you said I should take care. So what's the next thing? Silence. Oh, but God, okay, this. Silence. And one of the reasons you know that you are in doubt and you are in unbelief is that there are plenty of questions.
Yes.
I've been there. I'm just telling you my story. You see, there's nobody that has understood. God has helped me to understand this thing about calling. Because there are points in your life you come and it's not happening. And you're like, God, what's going on? And he begins to take you through. This is what you're doing. This is what you're doing. This is what you're doing. People, I'm not saying you should not hate, you love your family, but Jesus said, see, your love for him, there's a way you will love him that it will look as if you hate your family. I didn't say it is in the Bible. If we have time, I could have shown you. He said, let me first go and bury them which are my home and house. Look at verse 62. There are three tests here. He said, and Jesus said to him, no man, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. Now let's go to chapter 10, verse 1, and I round up. Chapter 10, verse 1. Thank you, Jesus. Are you getting something? I sense the anointing of the Spirit of God here. Look at chapter 10, verse 1. Luke 10, 1. After these things, the Lord appointed another 70 also and set them two and two before his face into every city and place whither he himself would come. It won't make sense to you until you discover this, that when he says, after these things. Which things? After they all came and gave their excuses, what happened? The Lord appointed 70. Other 70 also. And sent. Sent is apostolic. He gave them divine assignments. They entered into divine appointments. But those ones that gave excuse, what just happened? They missed their appointments. Especially the one that Jesus said, follow me. It was in this same place that when they came back, they said, Lord, even the demons are subject to your to us in your name. They missed seeing things. They missed seeing miracles. Listen, let's continue. Verse 2. Verse 2. Listen, God is not looking just for anyhow people. That's why he said the harvest truly is great, but what? The laborers are few. It's not that we don't have people hanging around. It's about how many of them are committed. How many of them are ready to go the journey? How many of them are willing to do what God would have them do? Many are called, but few are chosen. Stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. Many are called, but few are chosen. Many are called, but few are chosen. Lord, I will follow you. You know, that's a prayer. Lord, I will follow you. I mean, you must be within close range to tell him, Lord, I will follow you. None of them ever called him Jesus. Oh, boy. They called him Lord. They called him Lord. They were in the way with him. They were close enough to say, Lord, I will follow you. But have you counted the cost? A lot of us just jump into things. We don't count cost. But God is saying, I have a great plan for you. Much more than you have for yourself. I want you to lift up your hands and commit yourself to God. Commit yourself. But before we close, I'm going to make a call today. If you're here and you don't know the Lord Jesus, that's where it begins from. That's where it begins from. If you're here and you don't know the Lord Jesus and you would like me to pray for you, you would like the church to usher you into God's kingdom and his plan, I'd like you to lift up your hands. If you're here and you don't know Jesus, please indicate by show of hand so we can pray for you before everybody prays for themselves.
Praise God. We're here for serious business. This is not just go come. No. Not church. Not just come while we came for Sunday service. No. For some of you, it's an encounter of a lifetime. For some of you, it's a life-changing decision that you will make. If you're here, you don't know the Lord Jesus, please just lift your hands. Anybody here that doesn't know the Lord Jesus and you would like us to pray with you, you would like to commit your life to the Lord. Is there anyone here? If there's no one here, we're going to pray this prayer in Romans chapter 12. He said, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Just lift your hands and just rededicate yourself to God. Present your life before Him. Put it in the Message version so that people can understand. Because sometimes when they see this presenting your bodies as a living sacrifice, it may not be very, very clear to us. But put it in the Message version. He says, so here's what I want to do. God helping you. He said, take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life. Place it before God as an offering. It's not just when there is praise and worship. He said, in your ordinary life, place it before God as an offering. I don't know where you've deviated, but just commit yourself to God. And trust me, like Toma Kando, Debre Nama Nama Shata Kada Babaya Kataha, Lebre Nemende Bredo Boshodo Brakatanda Babraka Satana Brakatehia. In the name of Jesus. Secondly, we're going to pray this prayer because a lot of us have missed God's plan in different ways, including me. And one of the things the enemy badgered me with is that you followed money, you've missed the plan. For years, I struggled with that thought. Until one day, the Lord spoke to me and said, but Jonah missed the plan. But I still brought him back. I went out of my way to create a fish that will swallow him and re-navigate him. And when God began to tell me that, I said, oh, okay, you can read that. He said, yes. I had a plan for David. David committed adultery. David killed another man's wife, another man's husband. And yet, Bible says in Acts chapter 13, I think it's verse 56 or 36. He said, David, after he has served this generation according to the will of God, he fell asleep. Your mistakes are not final. Am I talking to somebody? I bring hope to you. Your mistakes are not final. So I want you to lift your hands and say, God, I recommit my life to you. I repent and I ask for mercy. Redirect me. God is master at that. Oh, God is master at that. Ask God to redirect your life. It is not a life-changing mistake. God will still make you a vessel fit for his use. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I yield my heart to you afresh again. I commit my life to you. Lay hold on me, lead me, show me the path, show me what to do. Oh, thank you, Father. 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 In the name of Jesus. Lastly, we will pray. We will pray this prayer like Paul did. He said this. He said, Lord, what would you have me do? If you're not ready to pray this prayer, you can keep quiet. But if you're ready, I want you to just ask God. Say, God, yes, I've been doing things. But Lord, confirm to me the things that you would have me do. I commit this to you. Pray about it. And God will speak to you. It may not come like thunder, but it will come from within. You will know. You will know. Ask God, what would you have me do? You have hustled too much. The hustling spirit is not a kingdom spirit. He leads us in the paths of righteousness. He prepares a table before us in the presence of our enemies. Hustling is not hard work. They are two different things. Hard work is work, knowing that God will give the increase. Hustling is working and thinking that you will give yourself the increase. Father, we thank you. You will show us what to do. You will show us the way to go. You will teach us. You will direct us, oh God. We thank you.
Thank you for watching today's broadcast. If you were blessed by the message and you would like us to pray with you, or you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, feel free to write to us via email, mails@harvestercity@gmail.com, and we will respond immediately. This message was brought to you by Harvester City. God bless you, real good.
Everybody
say amen.
God
has spoken.
So let the church
say
amen.